with anything he said. I was asked to talk about soft issues of identity, politics of identity, the meaning of a Jewish state while being a democratic state. How can you reconcile the two? And this is the story of our life in Israel. Okay, I'll get excited in a minute, don't worry. It'll take time. And in order to give you the background for the problem, to establish that there is a problem, I would like to start with a real story that happened in the year 1952, just after the birth of the State of Israel. David Ben-Gurion, the architect, the founder of the State of Israel, came to Bnei Brak, which is a suburb of Tel Aviv, ultra-Orthodox suburb of Tel Aviv, to meet an old guy called Chazon Ish, Rabbi Kreveritz. His name is Chazon Ish. And the two small-sized old people met in a naked room when the prime minister of the State of Israel came to visit the rabbi. And the meeting was an amazing meeting for many aspects. First of all, you have to realize that on the face of it, these two important people should have hugged each other, embraced each other, and feel like partners in forming Jewish history. On one hand side, Chazon Ish, the rabbi, the old rabbi, was there representing religion, tradition, Jewish continuity. It's very clear that Zionism wouldn't be relevant if Jews weren't survived by keeping religion all these years, for 2,000 years. Without religion, we weren't here. It's very clear. So the Goyim should have said to Chazon Ish, thank you so much for allowing me to build on top of you. And vice versa, you would have expected that Chazon Ish will say to Ben Gurion, you are upgrading Judaism. We were communities, we were victimized, the Shoah was over just a few years before that, and you are the one who makes us a nation with public sphere, with public goods, with army. Thank you so much. Right? Obviously wrong. Obviously wrong. This expectation is just mine, not anybody else. Ben-Gurion came to Chazon Ish to say bye-bye to tradition. He was rebelling, Judaism in its traditional way. From Ben-Gurion's point of view, and you have to hear that, it might be painful to some of us, but from Ben-Gurion's point of view, Judaism was alive in the Tanakh time, in the Bible time. And from King David to David Ben-Gurion, there was an emptiness, a vacuum, just for Jews. Talmud, Midrash, the Jewish bookshelf, all of this was almost not relevant for the first prime minister of the State of Israel. And there was a good reason for that. He wanted to redesign Jewish identity. He wanted to create the new Jew. He felt that continuity may cause Zionism to fail. His message was very clear. Forget about just for Jews. Remember the great days of the Bible and revive it today. And whatever happened in between is almost not relevant. He was looking for some kind of romantic leap through generations to the Big Ben-Gurion and Zionism, political Zionism. On the other hand, obviously, Chazon Ish, he was preaching for continuity. For him, continuity was the message. Rebellion is almost impossible from a traditional point of view. It's almost contradiction in terms. Keeping tradition or rebelling. For Chazon Ish, the old Jew should be remained and repeated again and again and again, and the future is in the past. So from this point of view, you have to realize that the two were actually in a wrestling match. That's why there was no dialogue in the room. And the ultra-Orthodox legend says, I don't know if this is true, but this is a legend, that that Chazon Ish took off his glasses throughout the whole meeting in order not to see Ben-Gurion. I don't know if this is true, but it tells you about the feeling in the room. Instead of a dialogue, you had two monologues that never met each other. No conversation, no real conversation between the two main characters of Jewish identity in the 50s, for 50 years ago. For Chazon Ish, it's quite clear, the State of Israel wasn't an end, wasn't a goal, it was just an instrument. For what? In order to achieve what? To revive the world of learning, of Torah, Yeshivot, the world that was almost distinguished in the Shoah time. And he felt, and he was right, that he can use, he and his values can use the political system called the State of Israel in order to rebuild what was taken away by the Nazis. This was his interest in this meeting. Now, you have to realize that in Chazon Ish, home, shul, yeshiva, schools, anywhere, you wouldn't see the Israeli flag. While in Ben-Gurion's home, there was no mezuzah. Just to give you an example of the two different poles that these two people were coming from, is that because of this total difference of opinion, they manage to coexist beautifully on a practical level. What's a trick? What's the magic? If you are Ben-Gurion at the time, you know that you're going to win. You just established a state. Modernity is on your side. Technology is with you. The media is yours. The religious sector will obviously disappear in just a matter of time. You should be rational, modern, self-secure, and religion will disappear. Faith can be personal here for a moment. I remember myself as a kid in Tel Aviv, talking about early 60s, being Orthodox and believer as a kid, knowing for myself that eventually I'll be like a small reserve for Indians in America. I know I believe, I know I'm this, this is my identity, but this identity is going to be soon very little minority, almost irrelevant. And Ben-Gurion felt this way at the time. So he was able to be generous. So he was able to let the ultra-Orthodox, for example, not to serve in the army. He was generous enough to allow religious law to be the dominant law regarding family ties. he allowed Orthodox people to have their own educational system, autonomy of education, etc., etc., because he was self-assured, just a matter of time. Why start a fight? That's Bilboa. Same time, Chazon Ish felt the same way, just the opposite. Chazon Ish represents Jewish identity for 2,000 years. Who is this little Ben Gurion that can change anything? It's just a historic mistake. Zionism is a historic mistake. It comes and it goes, and we are here to stay. And I know it because God is on my side. He has modernity, big deal. I have God. Therefore, it's just a matter of time till all the Jews will become like me. The truth wins eventually. And we have a promise from God, it will happen. So I can allow Zionism, and secular Zionism to be more exact, I can allow them to feel for the meantime that they can win. Therefore, I, Chazon Ish, willing to give up that Israeli law will not be based on halakha. What is now may be simple for us to assume that this is reality. At the time, it wasn't so simple. Because major component of Jewish culture is law, halakha. And the idea that the Orthodox people of the time will give up on Israeli legal system and make it secular was a big sacrifice from their point of view at the time. So, eventually, because the two of them were so assured that the other was going to lose, they were willing to cut a deal. And we call this deal the status quo, if you heard of this. It's some kind of balancing between secular and religious interest in Israel. Well, let's revive them and put them here, David Ben-Gurion and Chazon Ish, and ask them, 50 years later, are they satisfied? What about their vision? Was it realized? Did it become true? And if you don't mind, we'll ask each one differently, okay? Not together, because we don't have the time to start right. The life mission of each of them was realized beautifully. If Ben-Gurion will come here, he will say, well, look at Israel. Secular state, liberal, functioning beautifully, economy is great, security is quite okay. We survived it. I made it. So there's no doubt that Israel is almost a model secular state. No wonder that the gate between Israel and the world is named Ben-Gurion Airport. That's exactly it. He made it. He made Israel part of the world. Well, if you bring in Chazon Ish and ask him, he will say, tell me, ever in the past, did you have so many people studying Torah as a full-time job? The answer is clearly no. Not in Bavel, the time of the Talmud, not in time of Mishnah. Never before so many Jews studied Torah full-time job. He made it, Chazon Ish. This was his vision. Very successful. So we could go home happy because the both won. Now, this what I just described to you is the seed of the current major identity crisis. Since the two were not discussing anything, but pushing their separate visions, today we have no strategy, we have no way of reconciling the two aspects of Israel today. In today's term, we call it Jewish state and democratic state. But same tension as it used to be 50 years ago. If you come to people like myself, you know, trying to balance the two, I know, when I reveal to you, that even for me, as a personal person and myself, I do not have a real strategy to reconcile my liberal democratic life with my Jewish life. On Shabbat, I'm very Jewish. When I go to work, I'm very democratic. But that's not a big trick. How can you be very democratic on Shabbat and very Jewish on Sunday? I mean, Sunday here is different on Monday. It's even more so with the rest of Israelis. Either they give up on one or the other, or they live a schizophrenic life. Now let me give you some more facts to give it some more meat. At IDI, Israel Democracy Institute, we poll Israel on an ongoing basis all the time. And we ask Jews in Israel, I'm talking only about Jews today, we ask Jews in Israel about their belief system. For example, we ask them to say, are they secular, traditional, orthodox, ultra-orthodox? And then we ask them, what are their practices? What do they keep? What don't they keep? What are their beliefs? And the results are amazing. I would say counterintuitive to most Israelis. And again, we repeat these results all the time. First of all, the largest group of Israelis are not secular, but traditional. By the way, they describe themselves. The largest segment of Israeli society is traditional. Ben Gurion wasn't traditional, if he didn't have mezuzah, obviously. Then you ask them, do you believe in God? Very basic question. So if you read Haaretz, the newspaper, you may have a wrong vision of Israeli society. Because in reality, what you find out is that 77% of all Israeli Jews believe in God, including more than half of the secular. Those who say, we are secular, they do believe in God. And we're talking about a specific God, not a God. The specific God that presents here in this room. So what kind of secularity is that? Now, about 97% of Israelis place mezuzah on the door, on the doors. 99% are obviously doing brit milah, circumcision, etc., etc., on and on. It doesn't mean that they see all this as religion, but they see all this as something symbolizing their Jewishness. That's how they express being Jewish in Israel. On the other hand, and this is an unfortunate fact, when you ask Israelis, and we do, what are the major danger for Israeli society? We have so many problems, so many rifts, so many sectors fighting. What is the major problem you see for the future, for the state of Israel? It's not the conflict. It's not security issues. It's not economy, it's religion and state. More than half of the Israelis do believe that the rift regarding religious issues is now causing us to be in the middle of cultural war and may cause even civil war. How can you reconcile this with the fact that most of Israelis are traditional? Ben Gurion and Chazon Ish to be blamed. The founders of the state did not think through the meaning of being both democratic and Jewish. So this is a crisis. And it's very much alive today in Israel. What can be done about it? If you don't mind, I'll say what we at IDI are trying to do. Obviously, it's enormous, it's big, it's a life mission, and maybe more than one life mission. But what can be done and what do we try to do? And I will give you few beginnings of a talk, and then we can develop maybe a talk. This is about today's issues. First of all, as you probably know, Israel does not have a constitution. Israel and New Zealand are the only democratic Western countries without a constitution. What does it mean and why is it relevant? Nowadays, some Israelis do believe that Israel should not be a Jewish state, only a democratic state. Since they cannot reconcile the two identities, they prefer to go this way, not the other way. So it will be a normal state, a state of its citizens, without a Jewish character. It's too dangerous to be Jewish. Let's be normal. Once we will have a constitution, and the character of the state will be defined, this vision, which is an extremist vision, will be neglected, will become impossible. And the same way, the other way. I know many people who believe that Israel shouldn't be democracy, should be a Jewish state, should be ruled by religion, by Torah law. And it's not necessarily democracy. Once we have a constitution, which will define the character of the state of Israel, this vision will be neglected. It will become impossibility in practice. So the idea of a constitution, I make it very, very simple, is to have ground rules for the game, to decide, to make sure that we agree on the general picture of who we are. It's only a question of the character of the state. I'm talking also about practical solutions to practical problems. For example, the conversion issue. Who is a Jew? I'm not going to start unless you want to talk about it. It's fine. But who is a Jew? The biggest issue. Right now, the Knesset can change the definition of a Jew. The Knesset, the parliament, can change by the vote of 3-2. Do we want to live in such an uncertainty? Do you want politics to be involved on a daily basis in such an issue of identity? Constitution is supposed to help out. What is the character, what should be the character of the Shabbat in Israel? Jewish state. Obviously, Shabbat must be a different day. It cannot be like, I wouldn't say Paris, because Paris do keep Shabbat more than Tel Aviv. Okay, but Los Angeles. What is the meaning of Shabbat for us? Right now, it's a wrestling, non-stop wrestling. If you probably know, in Jerusalem, there is a Shabbat after Shabbat, there are demonstrations regarding this issue. It's time to resolve the issue and come up with a solution. With IDI, designed a piece of legislation that's supposed to solve the problem and can be acceptable, I believe, by 95% of Israelis. Or think about the idea that in Israel you can form a family only according to religious law, which means, to a large degree, unfair treatment of women. Or those who do not want to be married according to halakha, but still want to form a family. What solution do we give them? Do you want to force them to be halachic? Does it really mean anything to force somebody to do something against his will? Again, at IDI, we designed a piece of legislation that's supposed to solve a problem. On top of it, and I'm going to stop talking in 2 minutes, beside of the legal issues, beside of the constitutional solution, beside of using the Knesset, we believe in developing infrastructure that can build a bridge between the Jewish character and the democratic character of the state. What do I mean? Right now, when you come to many religious people in Israel and you talk to them about human rights, they feel threatened. Human right is some kind of weapon that liberals are using against religion. And vice versa, when you come to secular, many seculars in Israel, and you talk to them about the Jewish bookshelf, about the content of our tradition, about the possibility that there is something relevant to your life, they feel threatened. No, 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 this stuff belongs to Yeshivot. This stuff belongs only to the believers, it's not ours. So the idea we want to develop in the coming years is to change the attitude of both sides in the following way. We would like to open up the Jewish bookshelf in order for everybody, not only to a religious level, but for everybody to study it and to learn from it, but not everything, but specifically things which are relevant to a Jewish state. And I'm talking about human rights in Judaism. Is it true that the source of human rights movement internationally can be found in the Jewish tradition? I think so. I can prove it. It's my profession. I would like to show it to everybody. I would like to show it to my friends who are secular and afraid of tradition. And if this is true, that in our tradition you can find enormous development of human rights, I would like to show it to my religious friends. This is yours. It's not the enemy's. It's yours. You created it. You own it. So the idea is to create some kind of consensus between liberal thought and Jewish thought using the Jewish texts. And in order to do that, we would like to develop not only a school, not only a system, but up-and-coming generation of intellectual leaders in the state of Israel, and maybe also outside of Israel, that will develop this language and will own it and use it. And I do believe that eventually, in whatever, 15, 20 years, this might be the better solution for this dichotomy, so to speak, between being Jewish and being democratic. Thank you very much.